to give more than we either desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
You're seated for the ministry of the word.
A reading from Lamentations. How lonely sits the city that was once full of people. How like a widow she has become, she that was great among the nations. She that was a princess among the provinces has become a vassal. She weeps bitterly in the night with tears on her cheeks. Among all her lovers, she has no one to comfort her. All her friends have dealt treacherously with her. They have become her enemies. Judah has gone into exile with suffering and hard servitude. She now lives among the nations and finds no resting place. Her pursuers have all overtaken her in the midst of her distress. The roads to Zion mourn, for no one comes to the festivals. All her gates are desolate, her priests groan. Her young girls grieve, and her lot is bitter. Her foes have become the masters, her enemies prosper, because the Lord has made her suffer for the multitude of her transgressions. Her children have gone away, captives before the foe. From daughter Zion has departed all her majesty. Her princes have become like stags that find no pasture. They fled without strength before the pursuer. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's read Psalm 137 together. By the waters of Babylon we sat down and wept, when we remembered you, O Zion. As for our harps, we hung them up on the trees in the midst of that land. For those who led us away captive asked us for a song, and our oppressors called for mirth. Sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song upon an alien soil? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its skill. Let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth if I do not remember you. If I do not set Jerusalem above my highest joy. Remember the day of Jerusalem, O Lord, against the people of Edom, who said, down with it, even to the ground. O daughter of Babylon, doomed to destruction, happy the one who pays you back for what you have done to us. Happy shall he be who takes your little ones and dashes them against the rock.
A reading from 2 Timothy. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God, who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to your works, but according to his own purpose and grace. This grace was given up to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel, I am appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher, and for this reason, I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day that I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching and that you have heard from me in the faith and in the love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, 'Come here at once and take your place at the table'? Would you rather not say to him, 'Prepare supper for me, put on your apron and serve me while I eat and drink. Later you may eat and drink.' Do you thank the slave for doing what is commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you ordered to do so, say, 'We are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Grace to you and peace from the God who is, who was, and who is to come, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead. Amen. I enjoy a website that includes, among other things, church reviews from mystery worshipers. These mystery attendees visit a church, leave a card in the offering plate, and then later write online comments. One such mystery worshiper, using the pseudonym Amanda B. Reckoned With, wrote about visiting a community church in California. The preacher told his flock that he had given up a promising career as a naval officer in order to enter the seminary, going from receiving a steady paycheck to counting every penny. But a friend, having learned of this decision, told the preacher that he had made a killing in the stock market and wanted to share that good fortune. The friend gave the preacher such a large sum that it completely paid for his seminary education. Other unexpected gifts of money also arrived. Amanda, be reckoned with, commented that the preacher's unspoken message was, "Say your prayers, go to church, and fill out your deposit slip." Certain preachers offer a similar message, especially on TV, a message known as the prosperity gospel. You may know their names. If we attend worship, be nice people, give our tithes, study the Bible, and financially support their ministries, we will be blessed. We will get so much in return. So, in addition to heavenly rewards, the prosperity gospel promises financial security, happiness, and contentment. If committed Christian faith leads to blissful happiness and abundant wealth, today's gospel is extremely depressing. The apostles asked their Lord to increase their faith. Sounds good. But the Lord responds with uncharacteristic annoyance. "If you had the faith the size of a mustard seed," he scolds them, "you could say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you." He then uses a slave-master analogy that sounds harsh and wrong to our 21st century ears. Some biblical translations will soften the word to servant, but the original Greek word is doulos, slave. The Lord's words sound tough and impatient as he tells the apostles to regard themselves as worthless slaves and to expect no appreciation or gratitude for their labors, saying, "We have done only what we ought to have done." Or simply, "We did our duty." In these past weeks, the United Kingdom and the world have been mourning the death of Queen Elizabeth II. As queen, with a strong sense of duty anchored in her Christian faith, she faithfully served her people. She did her duty for over 70 years. But do your duty? When was the last time you and I have been urged to do that? Who does anything out of duty anymore? For us moderns, duty is sometimes viewed as negative. For some, duty implies blind obedience, mindless action, ethics that we are doing out of habit rather than choice. Instead, moderns prefer independence, choice, and reason. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, "Come here at once and take your place at the table"? Would you not rather say to him, "Prepare supper for me, put on your apron and serve me as I eat and drink. Later, you may eat and drink"? Do you thank the slave for for doing what was commanded. So also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, we are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done. We are surprised to hear this from our warm, gentle, loving Jesus. We don't expect to hear these words from the pulpit, whether in church or on TV. In other parables, good slaves or servants are commended, rewarded for their good works. Here, no one is thanked and certainly not rewarded. Is Christ really saying that there are things Christians do simply because they are what we ought to do? The apostles asked Jesus to increase their faith. He recognizes their faith, but then urges them to expand their faith. How is faith revealed and expanded? We think of faith as an inner belief that rises up within us. In this gospel, however, to grow and expand faith is by doing what we ought to do. The slaves are not pretending humility. They know they are to serve their master. The truth of the parable, however, is that believers will increase their faith as they graciously serve and sacrifice for others. When you and I love someone, we do all sorts of things that we might otherwise not choose to do. Followers of Christ serve him and all those whom Jesus loves because of our love for the Lord. That is what we are called to do. Christ himself leads us on this path of service. The Son of Man came not to serve, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. How do we define Christian duty and service? Would such duty comprise worship, faithful worship and gathering at the Lord's table? In the words of Holy Eucharist, Rite 1, in the Book of Common Prayer, it is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God. Would duty include faithful Bible reading and prayer? What about caring for the needy, the hungry, the despised, as Jesus did? Is it duty to give our offerings for the sake of the work and mission of St. Matthew Church? Millions of Americans have served in the military. Many, many made the supreme sacrifice. We are so thankful for their service. I think most of them would humbly say that they were only doing their duty. When we served in the United States military, we understood that we were being called upon to use our skills and abilities as needed. We didn't do it for any reward, but because it was expected of those who wear the uniform and love our country. That's what they say. Faithful disciples who wear the cross and volunteer to serve God's great company fulfill the obligations our commander gives, loving our enemies and praying for them, welcoming and feeding the stranger. We show mercy and share forgiveness. In these very fearful and troubled times, Have we become instruments of peace and healing, as St. Francis prayed? Do we follow along the road with the Good Samaritan, binding up wounds, giving shelter and monetary assistance? Will we take up the cross as Jesus did? We, like the apostles, pray for an increase of faith. But we grow in faith, not by focusing upon ourselves, but rather by listening to the Master and following his commands. The tough work of discipleship is the constant, daily, increasing challenge to take Jesus more seriously and ourselves less so. In spite of what we may hear, living out the gospel of Christ is not about self-improvement, contentment, or prosperity. Accepting our relationship to the Master as we have done only what we have ought to have done creates outward works and loving actions that increase faithful discipleship and open-handed, unselfish caring. Experiencing the privilege and hope of being children of God and having the opportunity to join with Christ in his labor and love is wonderful and God-pleasing, even when there is no word of thanks. Amen.
Please join me in declaring our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. She has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As the prophets mourned the ruin of Jerusalem, we grieve over violence and wrongdoing and the failure of justice. Grant us oracles of hope that we may strive for the right and the true and live by our faith.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases.
Because you are always more ready to hear than we to pray, stir our minds and hearts to intercession, that we may receive the abundance of your mercy beyond all that we desire or deserve.
God's mercies never come to an end.
Rekindle charity and every spiritual gift within your church, O God, remembering. For you have not given us a spirit of cowardice, but rather of power and of love and of self-discipline.
Your grace is new every day.
Great is your faithfulness.
Bless and strengthen the labors of this parish church and all our ministries, that your own good purpose might be seen.
The Lord is my portion, therefore I will hope in God.
Quicken us in service to the downtrodden and those suffering from any oppression, that we might do what ought to be done for their care and well-being.
The Lord is good to those who wait.
We honor and pray for our indigenous neighbors, especially the Akamal Oodham and the Peeposh tribes,
that we may dwell together in respectful harmony.
Remember our sick, Lord Christ, especially those for whom our prayers are now offered. Soothe the dying, bind up the brokenhearted, and give us confidence in the life and immortality brought to light through the gospel.
The Lord is kind to the soul that seeks for God.
Increase our faith even to the size of a mustard seed, that we might give ourselves the holy calling with which we have been called, and with the help of the indwelling Spirit.
It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we, your servants who now live by faith, may with joy behold your Son at his coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
We greet one another in the Lord's name. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
That morn shall tearless be.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Go into the world in peace. Be strong and of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord with gladness, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this Sunday and always.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
My life, the Father. Hallelujah. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.